right, Romans 14, 1 to 15, 13. This is a plea
for peace among the Jewish and the Gentile Christians in Rome, particularly with regard to the conflict that developed over the Jewish Christians' hyperactive consciences with regard to eating meat and observing certain holy days. In 14:23 through 15, verse 6, Paul exhorts, especially he's focusing on the strong, the Gentile Christians, and he exhorts them to abstain from eating meat and drinking wine in the presence of their Jewish brothers and sisters who believe at some level that that's wrong, that eating the meat and drinking the wine is at some level wrong. So Paul tells the strong, the Gentile Christians, to abstain from doing that in the presence of their Jewish brothers and sisters. He explains that it would be unloving for them to exercise their liberty in the presence of such a brother or sister, because that would put undue pressure on that brother or sister to act ahead of their conscience, to engage in the conduct before they were convinced internally that it was really appropriate to do, which would be sinful. And pushing a brother or sister to violate his conscience is a grave wrong, because not only is it deeply distressing, but it also can begin a hardening process that leads to spiritual ruin. When you begin to disobey your conscience, that can begin this hardening process. All right, I want to look at the concluding paragraph of this section, 15:7 to 15:13, and then I want to spend a fair amount of time talking about some issues of application of what Paul is talking about, and I'm going to share my thoughts on that with you. All right, 15:7 to 13. He says, "Therefore, welcome one another, just as also Christ welcomed you for the glory of God. For I say Christ has become a servant of the circumcision for the sake of God's truth, in order to confirm the promises to the fathers, and the Gentiles glorify God for his mercy, just as it is written, 'On account of this, I will acknowledge you among the Gentiles and sing praise to your name.'" And again it says, "Rejoice, Gentiles, with his people." And again, "Praise the Lord, all the Gentiles, and let all the peoples praise him." And again, Isaiah says, "He will be the shoot of Jesse, the one who arises to rule the Gentiles. On him the Gentiles will hope." May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. All right, Paul in verse 7, he urges the saints to accept one another as fellow members of a family because they have been received by Christ, and therefore they are fellow members of a family. They are fellow members of the family of God. And this kind of acceptance and unity, it redounds to the glory of God. So it's no trivial thing that we accept one another and receive one another, and he's telling them to do that, that they will do that, and because they are members of a family, receive one another like that, and in doing that, that acceptance and that unity redounds to the glory of God. And then in verses 8 through 12, he says that they also are to receive one another because Christ has acted to bring God's blessings to both Jews and Gentiles in fulfillment of Scripture. So he's acted to bring God's blessings to both. Christ became a servant of the Jew. He did that in order to show that God is faithful, which he did by fulfilling the promise of blessing that God had made to the Jewish patriarchs. He says, "For I say Christ has become a servant of the circumcision for the sake of God's truth, in order to confirm the promises to the fathers." So he had made promises to the Jewish patriarchs. Christ became a servant of the Jew to show that God is faithful, which he did by fulfilling the promises that had been made. He also became a servant of the Jew in order that the Gentile might glorify God for the sake of his mercy through subsequently being grafted into the people of Israel. You remember that thing in Romans 11 where here you're not a natural shoot, but you've been grafted in. So we have the church, which is Jewish at its root, You have Israelites who are true Israelites, people of the faith of Abraham who are Christian, and into them is grafted the Gentiles. So Paul is saying, look, he says that Christ became a servant of the Jew to show God's faithfulness to the promises that he'd made to the patriarchs, and he also became a servant of the Jew in order that the Gentiles might glorify God for the sake of his mercy through their subsequently being grafted in. So he becomes a servant, and in verses 9 through the second part of 9 through 12, Paul quotes a number of scriptures. And he quotes those scriptures and those texts to show that the inclusion of Gentiles with Jews in the praise of God has always been part of God's purpose, part of God's vision. He has always seen, ultimately, that Jew and Gentile together, all peoples would be joined in praising him. So Paul quotes a number of Old Testament texts to make that point. And then in verse 13, he rounds off his exhortation to both the weak and the strong with another prayer report. He tells them and gives them this prayer report, and he prays that despite their differences, that they will be filled with joy and peace in their believing, because it's only this kind of community, only in that kind of community, where you have this peace together, you have this unity, that you have, they'll be filled with joy and peace, because it's in that kind of community that the hope and peace, you see there, that the hope produced by the Spirit abounds. He says, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that you may abound in hope by the power of the Spirit. It is this, it's in that kind of context that if they will, you know, that they will receive and accept one another and be unified despite their differences, that they'll be filled with joy and peace in their believing, because when they're in that state, it is in that state, that kind of community, that the hope produced by the Spirit abounds. So that's what I say. When Paul talks about these things, about relationships within the body, they're not abstract and isolated from other things. That these things are part of the context in which Christianity flourishes, in which the Spirit works. And so Paul is urging them and telling them that. Now, the more joy and unity there is in our fellowship, the more joy and unity there is in our fellowship, the more the Spirit generates a genuine expectation of eternal glory, that you may abound in hope by the power of the Spirit. So these things are tied together. Let me give to you what Douglas Moo, in his commentary, how he summarizes chapter 15, verse 7 to 13. He says, both strong and weak Christians should receive each other as full and respected members of the Christian community, for God himself has shown, in fulfillment of Scripture, that he accepts both Jews and Gentiles as his people. Okay? Now, I'm going to... The last section, the letter closing, begins in chapter 15, verse 14. But before going to that, I wanted to share with you some thoughts about some application issues. Okay, Paul in Romans 14, 1 through 15, 13, he makes clear, at least I've done my best to explain that, he makes clear that it's God's will for a Christian to abstain from optional conduct when engaging in it, may encourage a Christian who believes the conduct is sinful to engage in it contrary to his or her conscience. It would be unloving to exercise one's liberty in the presence of such a brother or sister, because that would put undue pressure on that brother or sister to act ahead of his conscience. Okay, in fact, you see this same thing. Paul says the same thing in relation to the consciences of certain Gentiles. In 1 Corinthians chapter 8, verses 7 to 13, he says there that even if the arguments that some in the Corinthian congregation were making, there were some who were making an argument, look, it's okay for us to eat cultic meals in pagan temples. Now, Paul says that's nonsense in chapter 10, verse 14 to 22. He finally gets to the point and says, you're wrong. But in chapter 8, he says, look, even if that were correct, even if what you were saying is correct, the principle of brotherly love would still require you forego the practice so as not to push your brothers who are former idolaters into obeying their weak consciences, weak in that context meaning their idol-sensitive consciences. You see, so by participating in the meal, so he says, look, even if what you were saying is right, which it's not, but if it were, you'd still lose because you still would have to defer to the weak consciences of your idol-sensitive brothers, because in your eating in their faces, you would be pushing them ahead of their consciences. So it's not simply Romans that Paul says this. He says it in 1 Corinthians. So it's an important principle. And in a culture that glorifies freedom and glorifies majority rule, Paul's teaching on this subject, it meets much resistance. In fact, we don't like even to talk about it. Those with wider consciences often cannot bear even the thought of restricting their freedom for the sake of those they believe are in error, especially when those thought to be in error are a minority. That simply grates on us. We can hardly bear to even talk about it. There's this sense that we have that liberty is negated by any condition on its exercise, and there's a sense that the practices of the majority should not be circumscribed by a minority. So we have that sense in us, you see, and unfortunately that sense sometimes trumps the biblical injunction to love, and Paul's admonitions in Romans and Corinthians get rationalized away in the process. Okay, that's something that happens. We fear the truth. We fear the truth that we're to restrict our liberty out of love for Christians with a narrower conscience because we fear that it will inevitably lead to a church that is captive in everything to the narrowest conscience in the group. Okay, even if that were true, and I don't think it is true, but even if that were true, it's no justification for avoiding what Paul taught. Because Paul delivered the word of the Lord not only to the Romans, not only to the Corinthians, but also to us. Okay, so even if that were the case, I don't think it is the case, and I'm going to explain to you why I don't think it's the case. But even if it were, it would be no justification for avoiding what he taught. Now, I grant that wisdom is required. Sometimes great wisdom in moving from Paul's reasoning and instruction in the situations in Rome and Corinth to the kinds of cases that most often concern us today. But let's first allow Paul's teaching to sink in. Let's first allow what Paul's saying to sink in and have its effect on our hearts. Then we can wrestle with some of the stickier questions in moving from first century Rome and Corinth to the church today. But let's not rush past that in our fear that, if I say that and I realize that, then it's going to have a chicanery, so let's just trash it. Let's not do that. Let's allow what Paul is teaching to sink in and have its effect on us, okay? Now, I don't have all the answers, okay? I don't have all the answers in applying these things in the myriad of situations and permutations that come up. But in applying his teaching, I think it helps to keep a number of things in mind. Now, don't stone me for these ideas, okay? I'm just going to share them with you because I think that they're helpful. I offer them to you for your consideration because I think they're helpful in understanding. Part of the reason I'm convinced is that we like to ignore Paul's teaching is because we don't see the qualifications that are in it. And because we don't see the qualifications, we're afraid of touching it. But I think there are some qualifications in it. Okay, first, as I said last week, Paul is speaking about matters of conscience, not matters of preference. He's speaking about matters of conscience, not matters of preference. For Paul's teaching to apply, the conduct in question must be something the other person feels at least at some level is sinful. It is wrong to do. It doesn't apply to disagreements over preference, no matter how strong those preferences may be. You may prefer topical preaching to expository preaching. You may prefer discussion classes to lecture classes. You may prefer taking the Lord's Supper before the sermon to taking the Lord's Supper after the sermon. You may prefer one kind of worship song over another. You may prefer more worship songs over another, and on and on. And you may have good reasons for your preferences, but however good they are, those situations are outside the scope of Paul's teaching. He is dealing with what is believed, at least at some level, to be a matter of sin. And I think that's very important. Now, I think it's appropriate and even necessary for elders to explore alleged matters of conscience to satisfy themselves that it's not merely a matter of preference that's mistakenly being forced into the conscience category. I think it's legitimate for them to explore that. Not somebody says, it offends me, I think it's sinful to have a gray wall, or whatever color that is. All right, well, I think it's appropriate for them to explore that and see. And at that level, what they're trying to do simply is to see whether the brother or sister has any kind of basis for thinking that. You see, not whether they agree with it at that point. It's simply, can I see that there is some reasonable, rational, sane basis for this? And so I think it's legitimate. But anyway, the first point, the first qualification I think is important is that Paul's talking about matters of conscience and not matters of preference. Then second, Paul is talking about conduct that is done in the presence of a brother or sister with a narrower conscience. He's talking about what's done in their presence. That's why in Romans 14, the first part of verse 22, he tells those with a broader conscience to keep the convictions they have to themselves before God. And that's why he says in 1 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 10, he speaks there of one who sees them eating in the temple. Not just hears about it, not knows about it, but who sees them eating in the temple. You see, they are free to enjoy the liberty they have in Christ when they are away from brothers with a narrower conscience. Indeed, in chapter 14, verse 22, in the second part of that verse, Paul labels as blessed the man who can enjoy his liberty with a clear conscience. He says the person who can do that is blessed. So this has to do with doing something in the presence of the brother or sister with a narrower conscience. And this restriction, the restriction is limited to being, what Paul says is limited to being in a person's presence, presumably because doing something in another person's presence, presumably this winds up creating pressure on the person to engage in it before he or she is ready. So if, for example, a brother has convictions that he thinks it's wrong to play cards, you are perfectly free to play cards in your home, to play cards away from him, but what you cannot do is invite him to your house and play cards in his face. You don't get to say, look, your idea is stupid. I'm going to do this in your face anyway. You see, it applies to what is done in the person's presence. Now, you can think of other things. I left it at cards. But you could think of other things. But that's the principle, see, because there is a dynamic of pressure that happens when I'm doing something and modeling something in your presence. Third, Paul is speaking here and in 1 Corinthians. I mean, here and in 1 Corinthians, of conduct that can be imitated by the brother with a narrower conscience. And this is a qualification that I don't think is always appreciated. He's speaking of something, conduct that is done in a brother or sister's presence that can be imitated, that your conduct can induce them to copy it ahead of their conscience. When conduct that a brother with a narrower conscience can imitate, something like eating meat, drinking wine, participating in the cultic meals. See, when conduct that a brother or sister with a narrower conscience can imitate, when that's done in the brother's presence, the social dynamic, it creates an unacceptable pressure on him to engage in the conduct, to copy the conduct before that person is convinced inside that it's really acceptable to do it. You push them out ahead of their conscience, and they wind up violating their conscience, and that is sinful for them to do that, you see. Paul says that love will not subject a brother to that risk of sinning. It won't subject a brother to that risk of sinning. It will not risk pushing him in that way to act contrary to his conscience. You see, teaching him that his beliefs are incorrect, well, that creates pressure on him to engage in the practice. But that's acceptable. Right? Paul is teaching them right here. That's an acceptable kind or level of pressure because it's different from modeling behavior in the person's presence. Apparently, there is something about acting out right in your face that creates an undue pressure. Whereas I could say, as Paul says, no, that's not right. I know that all the stuff is eating the meat and nothing to it. Well, isn't he creating? Yeah, he is. But that's not the kind of pressure he's talking about. He's talking about the pressure of performing and doing it in their faces. Why? Because there's a dynamic at work there that apparently increases or is a different kind of pressure. And so Paul, that's what Paul is talking about. But some disagreements about sin are over things that are not matters of personal conduct, not behavior that a brother can be induced to imitate. Okay, a brother, for example, might think it's sinful for a church building to have a kitchen. Now, somebody who's watching this who has no familiarity with Churches of Christ may be going, what is he talking about? But those of you who are familiar with Churches of Christ, you know what I'm talking about. Okay, now it may be that a person, you know, he believes that it's sinful for a church building to have a kitchen. He has no problem with kitchens per se. He thinks it's fine for individual Christians to have kitchens. He has one in his home. He just thinks it's wrong for there to be one in the church building. Okay, now this brother is free to make his case to the elders about the sinfulness of church kitchens, as everyone is on your views. I mean, you go and say, no, I think that it is wrong. It is objectively wrong. Sinful for the church to have a kitchen. If he succeeds in convincing them, well, then they're obligated as servants of Christ to remove the kitchen, right? I mean, if you're a group of elders and you come to believe it's the will of the Lord that the kitchen's sinful, well, yeah, you got to get rid of it. But if he fails to convince them, you see, so he always has the option of arguing the merits of his view. Everyone does. But the question that Paul is addressing, if he fails to convince them that church kitchens are sinful, can that brother in that case fairly appeal to Paul's teaching to claim that even though he cannot convince them that it is objectively wrong, can he still appeal to Paul's teaching to claim that the elders are still biblically obligated to refrain from having a kitchen in the building to protect his narrower conscience? You see, that's the issue. Can he fairly do that? And, you know, now I see that situation as being outside the scope of Paul's teaching in Romans 14 and 15 and 1 Corinthians chapter 8. Now, I think that because the brother believes it's sinful only for a church to have a kitchen. But an individual can't act as a church, cannot act as a congregation, and so he cannot be pressured to emulate the practice of a church in having a kitchen. He can't be pushed to do that because he's an individual and his only beef is with the church doing it. Let me give you another example that may make the distinction clearer, this particular distinction or this qualification. If elders decided to incorporate a church, you know, sometimes you meet together and you're a congregation and you're not incorporated. And at some point you say, well, if, you know, people are giving us money and we really need a bank account, you know, and I don't want to be putting the money in my name. So I really want to have a, and the bank says, well, you have to be an entity. Okay, you have to be an entity to have a bank account. I say, okay, we need to incorporate this. So let's say the elders decide to incorporate it, and you think it was sinful for them to do that. Okay, but you cannot convince them that you're correct. Now, you may need to leave the congregation. You see, because rather than give tacit approval to what you judge is its sinful conduct by remaining a member, but the act of incorporating a congregation, see, that's not something that you can be pressured into imitating because you are not an eldership or a congregation. Paul is speaking of acts and conduct that I do in your presence that can induce you to imitate it, to act ahead of your conscience. And I do not see how you can be induced to be a church with a building, with a kitchen. How you can be induced to be a church that incorporates. Now, is that belittling you? No, I understand. You think that, and you're free to argue the merits of that. The question is, if you cannot succeed in convincing the elders, can you fairly appeal to Paul's teaching? My judgment is you cannot. And I told you, don't stone me. But I'm giving you my judgment on some of these things. You chew on them, because these are the kinds of things that keep us from allowing Paul's teaching to have its weight. Because we're afraid that we cannot in principle distinguish any of these things. And that once we swallow what Paul says, well, then we're all the way down in every matter to the narrowest conscience of the group. So let's ignore Paul's teaching. And I don't want to ignore Paul's teaching. I want to understand it. You see, and so that's what I'm hoping that some of this will help you. All right. Now the fourth one is, Paul's instruction was that the Gentile Christians abstain from engaging in certain optional conduct. Okay, eating meat, drinking wine in the presence of a brother with a narrower conscience. So his instruction was abstain from engaging in certain optional conduct, not that they forego less burdensome ways of obeying a divine command. There was no divine command about it. They were free. It was purely optional for them to abstain from eating the meat or drinking the wine. Abstaining was purely optional. There was no counterbalancing negative spiritual consequence. In that case of simply abstaining from meat or drinking wine, one is simply there giving up self-gratification. Is simply giving up enjoyment of meat and wine for the blessing of one's brothers and sisters. The situation, it seems to me, can be different when a brother's narrower conscience relates to the way in which a command is to be obeyed. Right? Paul wasn't addressing a situation like that. When the narrower conscience relates to the way in which a command to be obeyed, it seems to me that it can be different. In that case, deferring to the narrower brother can make obeying the command so burdensome as to become a roadblock to a person's obedience. There is now, in that case, you see, there's now a negative spiritual consequence that has to be taken into account that wasn't present in the situations that Paul addressed. There was no negative. It was simply self-gratification to bless brothers and sisters. But now when you're burdening the obedience to a command, I've got something over here I have to take account of. So to me, it's a different situation. Imagine that somebody in the congregation comes to the conviction that it's sinful to participate in the Lord's Supper using multiple cups for the serving fruit of the vine. And this person, he thinks that the juice must be drunk by all from a single container. Okay, this person, as always, he's free to go and argue to the elders that it is sinful for you to use multiple cups. If he succeeds on the merits of that and they say, that's right, I'm convinced it is the will of God, then the elders need to act that way. That's their shepherds. They come to believe that the chief shepherd says this is okay. But the question always is what if they fail to convince the elders? You see, if they fail to convince the elders that using multiple cups is sinful, the question is whether Paul's teaching, does it mandate or does it obligate elders to shift to one cup out of love for that person so as not to pressure that brother to violate his conscience? I am not convinced that Paul's teaching requires that. Okay, I'm not convinced of that. Unlike deferring to the narrower brother in the matter of eating meat, deferring to the narrower brother in the matter of communion cups, it creates a significant obstacle for others in observing the Lord's Supper. It creates a burden on them. Some people simply cannot overcome the sense of disgust and the concern over disease in drinking after hundreds of people. Now, granted that this gut-level aversion is not a matter of conscience. They do not believe it is sinful to drink from one cup, but it is a reality that seriously burdens their obedience to the Lord's command. So in this case, you see the effect of the brother's narrower conscience. He seriously burdens their obedience, you see? So we have that effect of that narrow conscience because of their aversion to drinking from one cup. The effect of that is then what? It is to pressure that brother or sister not to share in the Lord's Supper, which is a matter of conscience. You see, so the situations aren't exactly parallel. Because in the one, we have a command, and your narrow way is dictating how the command be obeyed. In this case, it is placing a significant burden on obedience to the command that will lead some people to abstain from sharing the Lord's Supper. Now, that's serious. Okay, that's serious. I don't believe that Paul's teaching requires the elders in such a case to close their eyes to that reality. To close their eyes to the fact some people have a gut-level aversion to drinking after hundreds of people, so much so that it becomes an obstacle to their sharing in the Lord's Supper. I don't think that they're obligated by Paul's teaching to close their eyes to that reality and to pretend that people are not thereby pressured to violate their consciences in sharing the Lord's Supper. I don't think that they're obligated to do that. As I said, the cases Paul addressed, there was no countervailing spiritual cost. I just think it would be not the right understanding to simply say, okay, that case, that's fine. I'm just going to ignore that. I'm going to ignore that you people are driven by that to abstain from sharing in the Lord's Supper, thereby violating your conscience. I'm going to pretend that you don't have a gut-level aversion that has that effect on you. I don't think that they're called to do that. You see, the Gentiles were instructed to abstain from purely optional conduct, not to abstain from all but the most burdensome way of obeying a command. Right, so in my judgment, I'm just telling you, don't stone me, I'm giving you how I see this. So that's how I look at that. And I see those situations as distinguishable. So you say, well, all right, well, has Paul's teaching now died a death of 1,000 qualifications? Is there anything left of Paul's teaching? Well, I think there is something left of Paul's teaching that applies today. In fact, I can imagine it applying in many situations, but the one that is perhaps most relevant today, at least in my judgment, is in the case of instrumental music and worship. Okay, many people, myself included, are convinced that it's sinful to worship God with instrumental accompaniment. Now, in churches of Christ, that should shock no one, but these days it may. Okay, but I'm persuaded of that. And if you're interested in why I think that, you can go to my website, which is theoutlet.us, T-H-E-O-U-T-L-E-T, theoutlet.us, and there's a paper there called Music in Christian Worship. And I've done my best to explain why I believe the way I do on that point. But there are many people, myself included, who are convinced that it's sinful to worship God with instrumental music. Now, that does not mean, by the way, I always want to put this footnote in here. That doesn't mean, at least in the way I understand things, that those who disagree with me on that matter are, for that reason, bound for hell. I don't believe that. You see, I don't believe that. I trust that the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ will cover this error, whichever of us turns out to be wrong. Because if I believed I had to hit every nail on the head, I'd have to quit. Because that's just how it is. Okay, I'd have to quit. But the fact I judge it not to be a salvation issue, people often, when you say that, will say, well, okay, then it's irrelevant. It's not. No, that's not it at all. The fact I don't judge it to be a salvation issue doesn't mean it's a trivial thing. No aspect of God's will is trivial. Okay, so that's a false thing that we've done sometimes. Well, then it doesn't matter. No, it matters because it's the will of God. I'm simply saying that if our grappling toward the will of God that you and I are both working for, you think this way about it, I think that way about it, that not every disagreement is going to damn us. Because understanding the Bible takes a lot of work. And you don't have to play in the world long to see that some things are more finely balanced than other things. Okay? Some things I can't decide about. Some things I can decide about. Some things I feel absolutely, totally certain about. All right? So that's why it doesn't mean it's not important. What we see happening in our brotherhood today are elders switching their congregations to instrumental worship. See, these men insist on engaging in the purely optional conduct of worshiping God with instruments in the assembly of the saints, in the presence of their brothers and sisters who at the very least are not fully satisfied that doing so is acceptable to God. You see, these Christians with the narrower consciences, they are being greatly pressured to run ahead of their consciences in this matter, but as far as I can tell, few people are concerned about that. I don't understand why this teaching doesn't have a more prominent role in this discussion. And I fear that it's because it's an obstacle to an agenda, and then it gets swept under the rug. Because this would be, well, I don't have to deal with that. I just want to bring it in, do it, and after a while, after they've done it long enough, they'll quit complaining about it. And I don't think that's a way of handling it. Okay? I don't think that's the way of doing it. Now, before I move on, I should suggest or mention to you that in my view, there is a more general qualification to Paul's teaching. I think there's a difference in what love owes to a congregational member whose conscience is put at risk by a change in practice and what it owes to one who joins the congregation knowing that the existing practices are unacceptable to his conscience. I think what love owes is different in those two situations. Love will not impose a conscience pressuring or conscience violating practice on another, but one who joins a congregation knowing that the existing practices are unacceptable to his conscience is voluntarily exposing himself to the practices for the purposes of changing it, for the purposes of setting these people straight. It would be like if I went to an instrumental congregation, yeah, I'm going to become a member. I sit down and I say, now you need to stop using instruments because of my conscience. I think that person is in a different situation than a person who is a member of an a cappella congregation that goes instrumental. Okay, so that's a general kind of global qualification that I think is something. Now, let me add before I'm finished here, a footnote about Paul's use of the term weak. This creates confusion, and just a kind of a little personal thing that irks me. All right. Paul's use of the term weak in Romans, okay. After this, we'll move on to the letter closing in 15:14, but I'm guessing that's going to be next week. We'll see. Maybe I can at least read the text. All right. Those who believe it's wrong to worship God with instrumental music, just take that example. Okay, those who believe it's wrong to worship God with instrumental music, they are similar to the weak ones that Paul is addressing in Rome, in that the convictions of both are relatively narrow. So they're similar in that regard. You see, that the convictions of both are relatively narrow. That's why both need those with broader consciences to limit their liberty. But they are dissimilar. The person who believes that it's wrong to worship God with instruments and those in Rome, they're dissimilar in that it's only the weak ones in Rome who are for certain in error. You see, who are for certain misguided. We know they are for certain misguided because we have the Spirit's word through Paul. But the instrumental music question is a long-standing and unresolved debate. It is at least, of course, the church didn't use instruments for probably 1,000 years. And then it comes in and you get some here, and then you have the Protestant Reformation. The current debate about it is at least as old as the Protestant Reformation. Not the American Restoration, the Protestant Reformation. As people like John Calvin said, instruments got to go. Okay, so that's an unresolved dispute. So we are similar to those fellows in that we have a relatively narrow conscience, but we are dissimilar in that it is only the people in Rome that we know for certain are in error. So to the extent that the label weak ones, to the extent that that connotes that one's view is in error, in addition to being relatively narrow, then I think it's a mislabel. You see, and I think it's needlessly alienating. Now, if you want to qualify it and say, I call you a weak one only to the extent that your conscience is relatively narrow, as were those in Rome, okay, that's fine with me. I mean, I'm not offended by weak one if we understand that it means narrow conscience. But see, what often has happened is somebody's trying to bootleg into that label the assumption that the view is wrong. And I won't let that happen. That's, you know, you can't get away with that. Because that's by no means clear, and in fact, I'm convinced it's not that way. Okay, let me read to you this text, and we'll begin. We're going to start. The letter closing is 15:14 through the end. And I'm hoping I have one more class. That's the game plan, because after that, after we have next week to finish Romans, and then after that, we're going to begin the overview of the Bible. We're going to do the Bible storyline. And so we're going to open up with creation to Abraham. I'm going to do that, and then I'm going to be gone visiting the world's cutest grandchildren. Okay, all right. And then after I do that, we're going to have another brother who's going to be doing Abraham, and I've forgotten his name, the fellow who's the missionary that we're supporting. My bad. He's going to be teaching here. He's going to be visiting. Ken sent me the note about it, and I can't remember his name. Kevin Carson. There it is. Thank you. Okay, he will be doing Abraham, and then Lord willing, the week after that, I'll pick back up. All right, 15:14-21. Paul says, now, my brothers, I am convinced about you, I myself, that you yourselves are also full of goodness, filled with all knowledge, able also to admonish one another. But I have written to you rather boldly in part, as one who reminds you because of the grace that was given to me from God, that I might be a minister of Christ Jesus to the Gentiles, serving the gospel of God as a priest, in order that the offering of the Gentiles might be acceptable, having been sanctified by the Holy Spirit. Therefore, I have this boasting in Christ Jesus with reference to what concerns God. For I will not dare to say anything except what Christ accomplished through me for the obedience of the Gentiles by word and deed, by the power of signs and wonders, by the power of the Spirit of God, so that from Jerusalem and around as far as Illyricum, I have completed the preaching of the gospel of Christ. But in this way, by striving eagerly to preach the gospel where Christ was not named, so that I not build on another's foundation. Rather, just as it is written, those to whom it was not announced concerning him shall see, and those who have not heard will understand. I know how this works because the bell's going to ring next week, Lord willing. Thank you for coming.